Hello everyone, my name is Francesca Servini and I'm the lead keeper on the herpetology section at ZSL London Zoo. I'm going to be presenting on the captive management of Congo Caecilians, including their challenges and future considerations. Most of the images used on these slides are from online and these will mostly be credited at the end. I will be discussing what a Caecilian is in terms of their distribution and biology, our collaboration with the Natural History Museum regarding Caecilians and research, and which species we currently hold at ZSL before moving on to formally introducing the Congo Caecilian. For this species, I will be detailing our past management and what we have currently changed, observations we have made during these changes, and what our future aims are in regards to managing this species. Caecilians, also known as Gymnophiona or Apoda, are phylogenetically placed in their own monophyletic group, completely separate from Chordata and Anura, which are in another monophyletic group. This goes to show how very unique they are compared to the rest of the amphibian taxonomic groups. While Caecilians more or less have a lack of variety in general body plan, they can look and live very differently from each other. Siphonops annulatus has beautiful contrasted striping along the annuli. Rhinotrema bivitatum is different in that it has the mottled dark colour over the dorsal area and solid yellow under the belly and on top of the head. Typhlonectes natans is a uniform grey colour like most aquatic Caecilians, and this is the only known lungless Caecilian species, this image being a Tritocoana, one of the largest known species of Caecilian at around 31 inches long. As they need to absorb oxygen through their skin instead, this species has folded skin that increases surface area and therefore oxygen intake. Caecilians can be found across four continents: North and South America, Africa, and Asia. Unsurprisingly, known populations are found close to the equator line. Just to give an idea of some species occurring across the world, you have Dimorphus mexicanum occurring from Mexico down to Nicaragua, Siphonops annulatus occurring throughout most of South America, Microcecilia unicolor is endemic to French Guiana. Typhlonectes natans is found in Colombia and Venezuela. Herpele squalostoma occurs in Central and West Africa. Scolecomorphus kirkii is found in Southeast Africa. Chiquila fulleri is from the most recent family addition to the Gymnophiona order. This species is endemic to India. There's Ichthyophis possusulcus occurs in Singapore and Indonesia, and Ichthyophis cotanensis is from Southeast Asia. All in all, there are now 10 known Caecilian families, supporting 32 genera and over 200 species. However, it is very likely that Caecilians have been undersampled due to the complexity in finding them. Caecilians fall under one of three ecotypes: fully aquatic, like Typhlonectes species; semi-aquatic, like Thunerpetum indistinctum; and terrestrial, like Herpele squalostoma. However, most species of Caecilians are indeed terrestrial, living at a variety of depths underground. All Caecilians have a tentacle appendage between the eyes and the nostrils that is adapted from what would be a tear duct. These tentacles are able to extend and retract when required, and they are used as an olfactory organ to detect prey and chemicals in the environment. The structure of the eyes are varied throughout Caecilian species, typically falling under two broad categories of animals with eyes under the skull and animals with eyes between the skull and a thin layer of skin. This is very likely linked to lifestyle and ecotype, in that Caecilians with heavier and more reinforced skulls that are useful for digging through tunnels have very reduced eyes that sometimes are just a mass of undifferentiated cells, and Caecilians with less heavily ossified skulls that dig less in softer substrates or have an aquatic lifestyle typically have more structured eyes that can be seen through a transparent layer of skin. Caecilians may look inoffensive on the outside. However, depending on the species, their diet and their life stage, they can come equipped with some very serious teeth. There are three reproductive methods in Caecilians: two oviparous types and one viviparous type. Direct developing Caecilians will lay eggs, which will then hatch into what effectively looks like a mini adult, therefore skipping any kind of larval stage and gill development. Genera such as Ichthyophis or Rhinotrema will lay eggs which will instead hatch into aquatic larval animals with gills. And viviparous animals like Typhlonectes will give birth to juvenile animals with very large but temporary bag-like gills. This image on the right is a still from a video at Tennessee Aquarium showing how Typhlonectes natans give birth. In order to highlight exactly how understudied Caecilians are, I did some searches on Google Scholar for number of results. In order to get the highest number of results for Caecilians, I searched Caecilian, Gymnophiona and Apoda. Apoda provided the most results at almost 10,000. Next, simply searching Salamander provided a much higher number at 164,000, and Frog churned up a whopping million results, and this was without trying to find higher numbers. Lastly, just to compare this with a reptile group, snakes are so well studied in comparison that Google Scholar found 1.3 million results. You can see why it is really important to continue trying to study this group, especially as approximately 65% of species are listed as data deficient on the IUCN Red List. This means that if a species is actually critically endangered, we won't know about it in time to help conserve them. The Zoological Society of London started to work in collaboration with the Natural History Museum in 2012, creating a partnership together with specialists from both institutions so that we could focus our attention on this understudied group of animals. Since then, we have worked on a number of studies ranging from husbandry protocols to disease to marking techniques and more. I will go through some of these in more detail. Due to the lack of distinct markings on individual Caecilians, ZSL and the Natural History Museum worked together to test visible implant elastomers as a permanent marking method. Other marking methods are not suitable for use due to the sensitivity, size, and sloughing details of this taxonomic group, and visible implant elastomer has been used to mark amphibians previously. It was found that although this could not work as a permanent marking method, individuals of Herpele squalostoma were identifiable for up to 191 days, which means that for short-term projects, this marking method could still be useful. This study from 2015 describes the successful treatment of Batrachochytrium dendrobatidis, the causative agent of chytridiomycosis, in Geotropetes seraphini and prophylactic treatment of Potamotyphlus calpii, as well as finding the first recorded instance of BD infection in a wild aquatic species and in a Caecilian of neotropic origin. Due to the lack of research that has been published on Caecilians, maintaining them in captivity is incredibly difficult and complex, specifically because we know very little about their preferences. We again worked in partnership with the Natural History Museum to design a choice chamber experiment with a group of Geotropetes seraphini to see whether they had a preference between coir and megazorb as a substrate. Megazorb is a paper-based substrate that is produced as waste from the papermaking industry. It is popular when maintaining captive Caecilian populations as it is clean and holds moisture really well. This study told us that this species much prefers the megazorb substrate, which gives us direction in the future for keeping this species and might give us a clue as to how other species might better thrive in captivity. In 2019, a paper was published by postmortem specialists, vets, the herpetology team, and the Natural History Museum to look at the postmortem findings in deceased Caecilians from ZSL London Zoo over the last 10 years in more detail. In order to start to understand where captive husbandry has its limitations, it was important to thoroughly examine the causes behind these deaths and whether there were any significant patterns. The most common cause of death was found to be dermatitis, where other common findings in these specimens were poor gut feel, kidney and gastrointestinal lesions, generalised congestion and poor body condition. At ZSL, we currently maintain two species of Caecilian: Typhlonectes compressicauda, an aquatic active species from South America, and Herpele squalostoma, a terrestrial species from West Africa. As with most aquatic species, Typhlonectes compressicauda are substantially easier to study due to the fact that you can clearly see them as they are aquatic, and because they are very active and respond very quickly and easily to food. This species is also easier to breed in captivity and is more robust. Herpele squalostoma is not like this, as they bury underground, are very difficult to observe for any behaviour at all, and have not ever been known to breed in captivity like other terrestrial caecilians. As Gymnophiona are made up mostly of terrestrial species, it is very important that we focus more on these species so at least we know the same amount about them as we do the aquatic species. Nevertheless, here is a video of our Typhlonectes on show at ZSL London Zoo, feeding on some crayfish tails. Herpele squalostoma, or the Congo Caecilian, is a medium-sized terrestrial caecilian with no visible eye structure, as it is present under bone. This is an oviparous species whereby offspring are direct developers who feed on the sloughing skin of the mother until they are dependent enough to leave the nest. The Congo Caecilian is of least concern on the IUCN Red List due to the ease of finding them on surveys. However, this does not mean that they are not worth attempting to breed in captivity. Any success maintaining and breeding terrestrial caecilians will vastly help us manage more sensitive and threatened species where we might not have as much time to get it right. In 2012, ZSL London Zoo, Project Cameroon Herpetology and the Natural History Museum published findings of the first reproductive observation for Herpele squalostoma. This is where evidence of extended parental care and maternal dermatophagy consuming skin from the mother was first noted. The first two images show where an attending mother was found with a clutch of juveniles, seen in this third image. Four of these 16 juveniles were preserved, and it was found that they had sharp, deciduous teeth and evidence of skin in the stomach. In captivity, the juveniles were also found to have increased in weight by 10% within the first month, without having been provided with any food from the herpetologists. This all supports the theory that this species is like oviparous species from the genera Boulangerula and Siphonops. A year later, a new paper was published detailing the find of a mother Herpele squalostoma attending a clutch of six eggs. This was the first direct observation of oviparity in this species. This mother and clutch was found in the middle of the first photo, approximately 10 centimetres under the surface. This provides us with valuable information on what to expect when attempting to breed this species and what kind of provisions they might need. At ZSL London Zoo, we have four Herpele squalostoma, two 16-year-olds and two 6-year-olds. These have been in our collection since 2008 and 2014 respectively, and since then have never showed any signs of reproduction. In the last few years, these animals have been managed in a large glass tank of 55 by 140 by 75 centimetres, with glass sliding lids to retain humidity and temperature. 45 centimetres of graded topsoil has been used as a substrate, cork bark hides on the surface have been used as warmer hides, and potential ways to mark presence and health of the animals. A philodendron species has been long-term used as planting to provide additional cover on the surface, with non-UV emitting T5 lamps provided for plant growth. The ambient temperature was held between 23 and 29 degrees throughout the year, and the surface temperature has mostly been kept around 30 to 31 degrees, which is heat kicked out by the T5s. These animals have mostly been fed on dendrobina worms, with the occasional cricket, pinky mouse and crayfish tail provided. This is footage of us releasing one of our animals back into the tank after it was moved to an on-show space. This was to facilitate education of the species for the public, as it gave them a chance to view them occupying their tunnels. Shortly after moving these animals, this paper came out over last winter, detailing dietary partitioning in Geotrapetes and Herpele squalostoma, where a number of specimens were preserved and their stomach contents analysed. In this graph, you can see the percentage of total volume of each prey item category for male and female Herpele. Considering that the animals maintained at ZSL were mainly provided with worms, worms actually make up very little of their wild diet. Using this graph, we wanted to change the way we feed our animals in order to allow them to gain more condition and perhaps take in nutrients that they needed to start reproducing. We chose to start primarily providing dead crickets as more of a staple, while also providing whole small river shrimp, which is close enough to crab for them to be interested in. Although the crab percentage is very small in this graph, it is more attainable than the other categories, and providing whole river shrimp will produce high amounts of calcium as opposed to the known low calcium content of dendrobina worms. That is likely important for reproduction and for maintaining their skeletal structure, which is very robust in the head area to suit their lifestyle. A few days after trying out their new diet, we started to see them feeding very often around their tunnel mouths, as seen in this video. Previously, we had no way of knowing whether or not they were eating the worms. However, by using dead prey items in this manner, we can easily observe and monitor the feeding patterns of these animals. This video was taken from the public side of the glass during the day, which is particularly exciting for us as it is such a rare sight for us to be able to provide the public with. While last digging them up, it was apparent to us that we had started to see less of them sitting under the cork bark hides and making tunnel openings, and we felt that this was very likely to do with the thick rooting created by the philodendron. Although when you first plant this plant, the roots are manageable and short, once a few months have gone by, the roots have penetrated very far down the tank and proceed to destroy tunnels and make it impossible to create openings at the surface. Due to the importance of the tunnels to these animals and how they likely provide them with safety and security, we try to weigh these animals only a couple of times a year, as digging them up as many times as we would weigh the other animals in our collection would likely massively contribute to the stress and ill health of the animals involved. Because of the importance of these tunnels, we decided we would next dig up these plants and look to replace it with something else that has short roots but still allows for tunnel mouth creation. While we dug up these plants, we attempted to find the animals so that we could weigh them. We were interested to see how the diet change might have caused them to gain weight, as previously they were simply maintaining a lower body score, which was not ideal. As we searched for the animals, we uncovered and exposed a tunnel which contained two Caecilians end to end. Forgive me for my low quality drawings, but as the observation did not last long, there was no time to take a photo. Caecilians typically mate by lining themselves up end to end, and the male penetrates the female by averting a part of his large intestine, which is adapted as a sexual organ, called a phallodium. This observation lasted about 30 seconds before the male and female split from each other, likely from having been disturbed. Once the female had disappeared down the tunnel, the male remained with his phallodium still averted. The phallodium was a fleshy pink colour and approximately was 2 to 3 centimetres long. This observation was a first for us as EDSL, and likely a first elsewhere in captivity. Although we had maintained the species since 2008, this was the first time we had seen anything like this, and it is likely that the diet change alone has provided them with enough nutritional variety to start trying to reproduce. From this, we started to think about nesting sites. Considering the kind of habitat they have been found in, we decided to use clay as a liner for different kinds of wood structures. We took two cork bark rounds and created several entrance holes for them before lining them with clay. We also found some hollowed out branching that, when lined, created some really nice den structures for potential lay sites. We proceeded to bury them, knowing that this was the last time for months where we would be able to disturb the soil. As we buried these structures, we exposed another tunnel with a male in the process of retracting his phallodium. This means that we must have disturbed another pair of Herpele during a mating event. While the first observation might have been a fluke, with the second observation, it is obvious that these animals have been very busy trying to reproduce. This is what our setup looks like now, from the service side. We have black lining taped to the side that might encourage them to use as much space as possible. Although their eyes are covered with bone, we still don't know if they have photoreceptors that are sensitive to light. We have a water area in the left, which allows us to maintain a kind of water table along the bottom 20 centimetres of the tank. This is important, as in the wild they inhabit areas where they can have access to this. Luckily, topsoil isn't very porous, so the water tends to travel along the tunnels and does make some areas damp, but doesn't effectively turn the bottom 20 centimetres into an unusable sludge. We frequently see our animals travelling through the submerged tunnels at the very bottom of the tank. The Echinodorus plant we have in the left provides some aesthetics to the tank, as well as oxygenates the water in the water table and processes nitrogenous waste. Here on the surface you can see the amount of tunnel openings the Herpele make. We use these as feeding areas by dotting dead prey items outside each tunnel opening. Although they appear comfortable enough to keep making these openings, we are currently looking for a good plant for the surface which won't restrict their enclosure usage so much and allows them some security. Fingers crossed, when we next check, we might find some juveniles. For now, all we can do is minimise disturbance while remaining vigilant when monitoring food intake and presence behaviour of animals through the glass. Currently, we know that feeding events have decreased since the mating was first observed, and Caecilians have been exploring the new structures we put in as some of these are against the glass. When we go to dig these animals up next time, we will need to do so very carefully and using small handfuls. This will take a long time, however juveniles can be as small as worms. If we are successful, we can report these findings and repeat so we can grow our population, and we can design some studies focusing on rearing juveniles so we can perfect it later on. If we are unsuccessful, we may try alternative methods of pairing in case the other tank mates are too disturbing for the mothers. We might attempt to sex individuals again, following reports that other institutions are somewhat able to visualise gonad structures. And we might try again as we have, but with more structured environmental parameters, like attempting to create a more convincing monsoon season for them. Before these mating events, we were gearing ourselves up to work on other studies with this group. However, these have been placed on hold until we can next catch them up. We are currently designing a temperature choice chamber experiment so we can find out what kind of temperature gradient they actually use and what temperature they prefer the most. And we are also looking at using macrophotos of annuli around the cloaca of these animals to see if any imperfections can be used as permanent identifiers of individuals. Here are the photo credits for the presentation. Thank you all very much for listening, and if you have any questions, please feel free to comment.